And thank you, Devdatta. So what I'm going to try and do in these 5 minutes is to try and see that what has been the approach of the courts, not just the Supreme Court, but courts across the country. And I'll try and flag the issues that emerge. So let's begin with looking at the Anuradha Bhasin case, where the doctrine of proportionality, which was one of the central pillars on which the privacy Puttaswamy judgment stands, was reiterated, reaffirmed in the Anuradha Bhasin case, and where the court very categorically held, the Supreme Court held, that state action, executive action, including of internet suspension, telecom suspension, crippling of freedom of movement under Section 144 of the CRPC, all this state action will be subject of judicial review, even in the terrain of Jammu and Kashmir, where there are national security and other similar concerns. And the principle of proportionality, reasonableness, necessity will be the test. While laying this down and declaring certain aspects of proportionality which must guide and all review to be accordingly measured, we see this judgment coming in January of 2020, and literally 4 months later, when a sequel petition is determined by the Supreme Court, by the very same bench, we see a judicial anxiety. So while the organizers of the program are looking at judicial enforcement or judicial evasion, I think we are at a time when what we are seeing in the court is judicial anxiety to take forward the right to privacy, particularly if you were looking through the lens of the doctrine of proportionality, which would curb, restrain arbitrary state action. The anxiety to enforce it with respect to rights of citizens is perhaps magnified in the order of May 11, 2020, the Foundation of Media Professionals, again saying, why only 2G internet and not 4G internet, which is really what one can work with in any manner. And the court not only exercises restraint, but actually says the executive will determine that, and that also officials from the center rather than only the state. Let's look at what is happening in other spheres. We see in Kerala, taking under the umbrella of COVID, we see the Kerala High Court allowing the police to access CDRs of people saying, oh, we want to see what is their location and see their tower location. And while the court says, well, don't use this excessively, but allows this kind of data to be handed over to the police, apparently to do some kind of tracking for COVID reasons. You see in the Delhi High Court, two judgments, which are cause of serious concern, I would imagine. One, a bail judgment, where the court says, not only of the accused, the under trial, will the under trial's mobile phone be 24/7 on and available for tracking, but the brother's phone will be available for or 24/7 on, and the two people who have stood surety, their phones will also be 24/7 on and available. So this kind of invasive measures that the courts are permitting in the name of enabling investigation to proceed further is a cause of concern. We have now seen, and I think the earlier speaker was referring to the election process, but let's look at the, what is this data that the Election Commission of India holds for a specific purpose. We have learned from one of the RTI activists of the country, Saket Gokhale, that this data was shared with pictures with the Delhi police for investigation of the violence of February 2020. Clearly, these violations are being made. We see the judiciary feeling some sense of anxiety, where security of the state, nation security, is once again not only is not being balanced, but is actually being prioritized, and the right to privacy is being seen more as something that is almost an indulgence that is available. And I think these are areas of concern. And we, of course, I would like to end with just saying, we saw this judicial anxiety and the judiciary pulling back from the elaborate articulation of the right to privacy in the Aadhaar judgment itself in Puttuswamy Part 2. So ceding space to the state and not center staging rights of citizens is seems to be the way forward that we are seeing. It is only in those little conclaves where it is not the state and the citizen between whose rights the adjudication is required, that the courts seem generous in their application of the doctrines which form the foundational jurisprudence of right to privacy. And here I would refer to the Joseph Schein judgment, which decriminalizes adultery, as well as, of course, Nafte Johar, which decriminalizes homosexuality. In those spaces where it is between the individuals, that the court seems much more generous in adhering to it, to the principles laid down in the 9-judge bench, Puttuswamy judgment. I'll end here.